Hey, stop right there. Even if you accidentally clicked on this video, please just give it a chance. That's all I'm asking. Even if you only make it 30 seconds in, please just give this video a chance. I tried very hard on it. And also, I would like to apologize in advance for both my mic and the sound of my voice. It is allergy season where I'm from, and so the voice quality and mic quality changes throughout. I can't really help that. Now let's get on with the video. What is Bioshock? I mean, a simple Google search will tell you it's a near 15-year-old FPS. But I didn't make this video for boring stuff like that, or for its age does not matter to me. I'm playing this game in 2023, and I do not care. I plan on making content off of this, and I plan on making good content off of this. And I believe any gamer has a timeless game. A game that they can't help but go back to, or desperately want to go back to, despite its increasing elusiveness to the mainstream as the years go by. And this is my game, and I'm going to play it. So, I ask again, what is Bioshock? What makes Bioshock Bioshock? And why should you care? Those are the questions I racked my smooth little brain for. So, what did I do? And how am I going to present it? Well, watch and find out.
Andrew Ryan, and I'm here to ask you a question. Is a man not entitled to the sweat of his brow? No, says the man in Washington, it belongs to the poor. No, says the man in the Vatican, it belongs to God. No, says the man in Moscow, it belongs to everyone. I rejected those answers. Instead, I chose something different. I chose the impossible. I chose rapture.
Now, what makes Rapture such a great setting? This underwater utopia founded upon the materialization of dreams, hopes, and freedoms is now nothing more than a den of nightmares, with both its citizens and itself falling apart at the very seams. This setting is a perfect clash of unworldly fantasy and a grim reality in which creators had a great foresight of sorts when approaching this uniqueness. Now, with not just the environment perfectly enhancing the experience and the characters, but also the direction they chose in their storytelling, they seem to have known how much reading pages and pages of lore can drag a game down and took a much more unique approach, allowing more freedom. They chose to build Rapture through audio logs, in which there are quite a few, and visions of the past, both which one could leave or listen to while not at all being taken out of the gameplay. So now, the moment I bet you've all been waiting for, the plot. Let's get into it. Originally, I was going to do some overly complicated telling of the story, using a lot of in-game quotes, super epic visuals, my own dialogue, and all this snazz, leaving out the absolute minimal details so you can get a perfect picture of what this game is. However, what's the fun in that? Then you don't have nothing left to experience. So now I'm doing a much more minimalistic approach, if you want to call it that, leaving out a great deal of finer details, characters, and plot development in favor of making you, the watcher, want to play this game. So, you play as a protagonist named Jack. Jack Bioshock. Origins unknown, in which after the unfortunate crashing of your local airliner, so local that you're on it, you find yourself at the entrance to Rapture in the bright year of 1960. You find yourself quickly picking up a radio and attempting to help out the locals, specifically a kind man named Atlas, in which you promise to help him and his family escape being the gentleman you are. However, this quickly becomes an issue as you are attacked as a filthy landlubber spy by Andrew Ryan, the Lord, Savior, Creator of Rapture. Atlas very quickly explains the ways to survive in this forsaken place. Adam. No, not a man named Adam, but the resource. The newfound resource is what made Rapture both possible and simultaneously fall to bits and pieces and completely crash and burn. We'll get into the details later of exactly why it's so important. The quickest and near only way to get Adam is through little sisters, little girls corrupted and formed by the society for harvest, particularly this individual resource. These little sisters are heavily protected by the entities known as Big Daddies, genetically modified super soldiers. Atlas tells you to harvest them to get a maximum profit, while a local, Dr. Tenenbaum, creator of the little sisters, tells you to save them. Either way, you have to get through the Guardian first, the Big Daddy. And depending on your choices, you have a few possible endings to your Bioshock experience. And after deciding the path you wish to take in that regard, you rapidly make your way through the rest of Rapture. Atlas eventually guides you to a sub that his family is hiding on, which in simplest term, doesn't go very well.
You ooze in like an assassin, and then you try to sneak out like a thief. You're no CIA spook. Who are you? Why have you come here? There's two ways to deal with a mystery. Uncover it, or eliminate it.
With a newfound hate, your mission changes from escaping to finding, and of course, killing the causes of all your issues, Andrew Ryan. And after a variety of Scooby-Doo traps and challenges set up by him, and a, quick intermission with Sander Cohen.
Ah, that's better. Atlas Ryan. Atlas Ryan. Da 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 da. Time was, you could get something decent on the radio. The artist has a duty to seduce the ear and delight the spirit. So say goodbye to those two blowhards, and hello to an evening with Sander Cohen.
Now, after that absolutely lovely experience that was not in any way awful, you find yourself having crafted a bomb to get into the office of Andrew Ryan. Now, let's take a short break from talking about the plot to talk about some game mechanics. First off, plasmids. With the discovery of Adam, mankind has gained the mind-boggling ability to control their very own DNA. This, of course, allows for our gaining of, well, a lot of power. And it doesn't really take a genius such as myself to see how this is an issue even at a surface level. On top of this, the overusage of Adam and gaining of plasmids makes your DNA unstable, causing mental and physical breakdown. That's how splicers, the main enemies of the game, came about. Now a quick word from our sponsors, Ryan Industries.
Light up foes to 1,000 degrees. Warning, fire spreads. Throw objects at foes. You can even catch grenades and throw them back. Trick the security system. Set security bots and turrets on your enemies.
I honestly just thought this next clip was funny. Next up, hacking. Man, doesn't that just seem like a blast? Hacking honestly is a joke of a mechanic in this game, but an important one nonetheless. Gives you the abilities to bypass sentry turrets, safes, doors, anything that's in your way, you can probably hack it. And if for some reason you just can't seem to wrap your head around those pesky puzzles, you have the fantastical ability to bribe machinery so you can just throw money at your issues just like any other problem in life, and you can solve that pesky puzzle.
Now, would you kindly find a crowbar or something?
Well, there's a lot more to this game than just a wrench or crowbar. However, not all of it's worth showing off, but there's a lot to use here. Pea shooter. Definitely not worth showing off. It's a piece of garbage. The Tommy gun. Specializing in firing hot lead faster than you can think, it is great for a variety of situations and killing a multitude of enemies at once. The shotgun. Great for killing multiple enemies close up, however, quickly falls off any closer than point-blank range. The grenade launcher. We didn't have a single good clip of this. The flamethrower. This is a fun one. specializing in, well, throwing flames. The flamethrower also has a variety of ammo types, allowing you to also shoot electricity or cryo rounds. However, we don't really have good footage of each, so we're not going to include that right now. The crossbow. Nearly effective to any enemy type in the game, it's a high damage weapon at any range. However, it's greatly held back by its single fire capabilities. Oh, I get what you're saying. But okay, all joking aside, the research mechanic is actually quite a great mechanic for this game and sort of carries it a little bit. The research mechanic is basically you just run at enemies with a camera out and none of your weapons, so you can take pretty little pictures, and it gives you a variety of bonuses. At a base level, it gives you damage buffs and passives unlocked versus that specific enemy type. However, it also is the only way to unlock certain plasmids or passives that you can equip, so overall it's a good mechanic. So let's get into the conclusion of the plot. I will go ahead and say, this will include spoilers for, of course, the ending and any twist it may have, so if you're on the fence about that, it's your fault for not playing this game, and I don't really care. So, I will say that I'm in the belief that I won't be able to do this game justice, with my poor monologuing and editing skills. So I'll be letting the game explain itself a bit here, you'll see what I mean in a moment. So we left off having built a bomb to get into Andrew Ryan's office. As he is facing impending doom, he quickly sets all of Rapture to blow as any sane person would do, in which the only way to stop it is a key on his body. Having shut off the power to his doors, we sneak through the vents to get into his office, in which on our way there, we stumble across some weird conspiracy room, something about a mind control project, rapidly aging a baby and implanting memories, you know, not important stuff. And after that, we finally come face to face with Andrew Ryan.
The assassin has overcome my final defense, and now he's come to murder me. In the end, what separates a man from a slave? Money? Power? No. A man chooses. A slave obeys. You think you have memories? A farm, a family, an airplane, a crash. And then this place. Was there really a family? Did that airplane crash? Or was it hijacked? Forced down by something less than a man, something bred to sleepwalk through life until they are activated by a simple phrase spoken by their kindly master. Was a man sent to kill, or a slave? A man chooses. A slave obeys. Come in. Stop, would you kindly? Would you kindly? Powerful phrase. Familiar phrase.
Would you kindly?
Would you kindly get this?
Would you kindly find that?
Would you kindly find that?
Would you kindly find
that? Would you kindly get this?
Would you kindly head to Ryan's office and kill the son of a bitch?
Sit, would you kindly? Stand, would you kindly? Run! Stop! Turn. A man chooses. A slave obeys. Kill! A man chooses! A slave
face! Obey!
Hurry now! Grab Ryan's genetic key! Now would you kindly put it in that goddamn machine?
It's time to end. There ain't no Atlas, kid. Never was. Selling my line of work takes on a variety of aliases. Hell, once I was even a Chinaman for 6 months. But you've been a sport, so I guess I owe you a little honesty. The name's Frank Fontaine.
I gotta say, I had a lot of business partners in my life, but you, of course, the fact that you were genetically conditioned to bark like a cocker spaniel when I said, would you kindly, might have had something to do with it, but still. Now, as soon as that machine finishes processing the genetic key you just fished off Ryan, I'm gonna run Rapture. Tits to toes. You've been a pal, but you know what they say? Never mix business with friendship. Thanks for everything, kid. Don't forget to say hi to Ryan for me.
So after a mind-boggling turn of events, you find yourself dirtied and used, thrown away like an old rag. And within your grand escape, you are reached out to and contacted by Dr. Tenenbaum. You know, the creator of the little sister, mad scientist, who through some kind of compassion helps you break past your mind control, helping you plot to take revenge against Fontaine, in which, knowing he has access to all the atoms in the city, you prep for a serious fight. So of course, you decide to become stronger. And what's the strongest thing you know? That's right, the Big Daddy. So after finding all the components to become one, and fighting the thankfully temporary battle between you and the awful FOV provided by the Big Daddy Helm, you reach Fontaine for the final fight. And of course with a fixed FOV, eventually coming out on top. And depending on your choices, you have a few endings available to you, in which I won't get into the details here. And that concludes the Bioshock experience. But that still leaves a couple questions. Like why I made this video, and why wasn't it more thorough, are two examples. Originally, I thought this video would be unique. I thought, there's no way anyone has done anything over Bioshock in years. I was wrong. I was very wrong. I also, of course, did this because I love this game, which, of course, still stands very strong or I wouldn't have done this. However, why exactly did I make this video? I mean, there's a lot more retrospectives and game reviews over Bioshock than you may think, and I would be lying if I said mine was the best, even though I don't really consider this video a game review or a retrospective. And what I mean by that is I'm not breaking the game down thoroughly enough for me to consider it a game review quality, nor am I dissecting its origins and history to somehow qualify how great it was and still is. However, this video does include aspects of both. I just don't think I do either well enough or long enough for it to be tagged as such. Simply, I made this video because I wanted to. Originally, I wanted this video to be longer, somewhere between 30 and 40 minutes. But then I figured no one would watch it. Plus, with my lack of editing skills, despite my relatively high creativity, I knew at least for now that I would be biting off more than I can chew. So I decided against that. And I didn't want more people to watch this video for views, nor do I really think this video would get that regardless. Heck, I would be surprised if even 20 made it this far. And yes, that's something I can check. I was just hoping by making this video shorter, more people would see Bioshock. This video is condensed to say the least, and I left a lot out, and I mean a lot of details. I left out a multitude of characters, most of the levels and their designs, the specifics of nearly every mechanic of the game, a lot of the mechanics of the game, huge plot details, and the list just drags on. There was a lot I wanted to include, and I decided against it. A great majority of it, at least. Maybe in the future I'll have more focused videos over varying Bioshock content. However, I feel this video served its purpose. I showed off a very selective list of Bioshock uniqueness, and got to talk a decent bit about one of my favorite personal games of all time. And my only hope with the Bioshock experience is that even one person becomes interested. That one person saw enough of the game to want more. Thank you anybody for watching, and I'll see you in the next one. Bye.
Honey, the moon belongs to everyone.